Take two tracks and call us in the morning. It's the Spin Doctors. We're back, baby. That's what
we come back.
Hey, there he is, Nick, coming in, hopping in hot.
Hey, baby, hey, baby, hey, baby, swing.
Oh, my God, he's got a baseball bat. Everybody watch out.
Yeah, I was trying to get on that level, because you always bring in that fire at the beginning, like a crazed...
Oh, I appreciate that.
Like a crazed Nicolas Cage movie.
I feel like if I come in real hot, that gives me, like, carte blanche to then fall off the end later, like, energy-wise. Mm. So I don't, maybe it's bad. Maybe I'm expending it all at the front so that I don't have enough for the back.
It's a marathon.
You know what? If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Hey, you got here. You're here and you're doing.
I'm a short distance sprinter.
From the couch to the refrigerator. Am I right, ladies? Come on here.
What is the last time I'm Rick Storr, obviously. That's Nick Malizia. He's here. I'm here. We're all here. Nick, what's the last time you ran? Like, legitimately, when is the last time you sprinted?
Oh, well, like a dead sprint?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, like, honestly, probably, you know, in the last couple days, just because, like, have a 7-month-old puppy, and so, like, you know, just a lot of activity, but, like, I still feel like I used to run track in high school. Humble brag, you know, made varsity as a freshman, broke a couple records, whatever. I don't like to talk about it.
The humblest brag.
But I feel like I still got it. And so, like, I'm always trying to race the dog. And I do, not only do I not have it, the dog has it more than I ever had. And hurt myself so much. It is tight. I don't remember my legs being so heavy. I don't know if it's fat or just lack
of
exercise.
You ever pull a hammy chasing that boy?
No, I stretch. I'm not a rookie, okay? I know to stretch before any type of activity.
You know, I heard a thing that said that people that stretch all the time and people that never stretch generally don't hurt themselves when they're exercising. It's the people that only stretch sometimes that end up hurting themselves more. Because their muscles only sometimes get used to. I don't know. It could be bullshit. You don't believe everything you read, Nick. Don't just take something that you've read one time and espouse it on a podcast like it's an absolute fact. That's irresponsible. You can't be doing that.
Oh boy, I need to start deleting.
I can't remember
tweets,
the last time I sprinted.
Yeah.
Probably when I used my cell phone.
We're going to need,
you know, that's the kind of comedy we like to bring to the show. You know what?
What else
I think that
like
was pretty
to bring
quality.
To the show?
Is it time?
It's time.
Is that a not so subtle hint? Okay.
No.
I would like to bring, Nick, why don't you do the honors this week?
Okay. Oh man, this is nerve wracking. I don't do this. I don't like this. I'm not doing it.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to bring to the podcast.
I'll do it. Let me do this. I will do this.
Okay.
He deserves it.
All right. Let me do it. Let me do it. Ladies and gentlemen. Oh, no. Okay.
No,
go
okay.
Ahead.
I'll do it. I'll do it. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Gentlemen and ladies, we and puppies, because my dog is listening. She's a big fan.
Good
our guest today is a legend of a man, a beautiful soul. Some would call a traveling man, a reckless man, a rambling man. He's very talented. He's a sweet boy. He's a musician. He's an artist. He's a husband. He's a lover. He's a fighter of civil rights, of
women's rights.
Wait a minute,
he fights civil rights?
He fights with them. He's right there. He's Iron Man.
For them. Oh,
and
four. Okay.
Captain America. He's the one and only Mr. Clarke Andros.
Yo!
Yay.
Yes.
What is up?
I give a snap applause.
Right on.
Like right as I said your last name, I did say your last name correctly, right?
Yeah, Andros. Not to be mistaken with Andross, the final boss in Star Fox for N64. Little known.
Oh, we got a gamer. It's time to talk some gamer talk.
Yeah.
We
That's right, ladies
and
gentlemen. It's time for gamer talk.
Yeah, so
this is the podcast within a podcast, where we talk about games and gaming and gamer stuff.
Yeah, 0110110.
So Clarke, let me ask you a question.
What's up?
Nintendo.
Yeah, you know that they've been a company since like 1890?
What?
Did you know that? What? Nintendo? Yeah.
They've been making video games since the 1800s?
They've been making games for like Japanese children. That's what they did. They made like toys and stuff and like games and all back in the day and like weird instrument, you know, like.
Do you know like what kind of games?
I don't know, but I saw a sign. It was like the first Nintendo shop in Japan. And it was from like the 1800s. It was wild.
That's crazy.
I had no idea.
Damn.
Yeah, they adapted.
Can you imagine if they had like a Super Nintendo in the 1800s?
Yeah, man. I mean, just.
I feel like it would have been just like
back home to their wives. They were like wives knocking on the door, like trying to get into the guy playing Nintendo. He's like, "My dearest Martha, I cannot come to the door, for I have been traveling with Samus to defeat the Metroids."
I think they'd maybe look a little bit happy in their photos. Nobody ever looks happy in their photos from back then. You know, they all look
miserable.
That's
true.
Yeah, they all look miserable.
When did it become cool to actually smile in photos? Because I feel like it was always, you just had to look as serious and concerned as possible. Everybody looked like they were being photographed mid-dump.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know, you know, maybe it was part of the Red Scare program. They just, like, American families started smiling, Russian families started frowning.
Oh, yeah.
Turned it around on them. It's like that era, you know, that Mad Men 60s advertising, 50s advertising, everybody's smiling in the photos, right?
Smile, you're on capitalist camera.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's where it's from.
Clarke, what's like, do you have like an all-time favorite video game, or is there like a series that like you're a big fan of, like that you kind of like have grown up with? Like what's, do you still play video games?
Nintendo's, no, I don't. Sadly, I don't. That's another thing my
students... Oh, fake gamer. Gamergate.
Yeah.
Gamergate.
Yeah, I know.
Gamergate.
Gamergate. I'm outed. So, yeah, I stopped with the N64, and then I try to, like, play every once in a while when I'm with my brother-in-law. He has an Xbox, but it is so overstimulating that I can't function. You know, my hands freeze up. The graphics are just too real. Like, the shooter games, it's like we had GoldenEye, and it literally looked like they molded the figures out of butter. You know what I mean? Or like, they were just weird-looking, gloopy figures. And then now it's like, you feel like you're actually committing real
and
atrocities.
For odd job, they only use a half a stick.
Yeah, half a stick.
And then now it is actually Daniel Craig in your living room killing people, and you have to clean up the blood after you're done with the game. That is quite the jump. I mean, really, like, Nintendo 64 to, like, an Xbox One is just, like, what has happened in the last, like, 20 years?
Yeah, it was jarring. Felt like a time traveler.
Well, I think it's because it's as video games became more targeted for Western audiences. Because when it was in, you know, Japan, it was little kids with swords and fighting spaceships with shooting Megatron blasters and transforming robots and crazy dolphins and stuff like that. And then it started getting targeted for America, and they're like, let's make war everything. Call of Duty. Every 6 weeks, we put a new Call of Duty out.
Yeah. So, it's just, man. The military-industrial complex, I guess, is just farther reaching than we thought. Because that has to be directly related.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my That's God.
That's what Eisenhower was warning us of.
Video games?
He was warning us of Call of Duty Modern Warfare 3 Remaster X719 Double XP Weekend.
Sweet Jesus.
And that's been Gamer Talk.
Oh, God.
Back to the Spin Doctors.
I maxed out.
Let me ask you a question, Clarke.
Yeah, what's up?
Nintendo?
All right, it's the one video game I played. I'll be honest.
I play a lot of video games. That's probably the thing that I'm least proud of that I do hobby-wise is play video games, because I will have hours of my life sucked away into them. Because they are so realistic, it's like a second life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you are constantly being prompted to do a new thing. So I'll be playing, you know, an Assassin's Creed game, and it's like, oh, you know, go travel to this place and kill this person. And so I'm like, okay. And I travel through this beautiful, lush countryside that
you
I don't
have
get
to
see.
Literally,
and it looks almost
like through planes. Like, it is like a 10-minute journey to get to the destination, sometimes longer, right?
Yeah. and you're just like seeing all this amazing stuff, and then you go kill a guy, and as soon as you do that, you know you would think, oh, the mission's over, I get to, you know, I could turn the game off at this point. But as soon as you kill him, it's like, oh, real quick, you just killed him, but if you go talk to this real person, you'll finish this other quest. And you're like, oh, well, they're right there, I might as well. And you get sucked in, and it's a vicious cycle. And you know what, the military industrial complex has come too far.
That's really the point of the show. You just described fiction. I mean, it's all the same, like whether it be a video game or a book. I mean, people are doing the same thing. People just, when they just get sucked in, they can ignore everybody else. Don't be so down on yourself, you know?
See, look it up. That's Clarky boy for you. Always.
Yeah, but it just doesn't sound cool to say that I was doing that.
Chin up and own it, you know?
You know what? Yeah, hell yeah. You know what? Fuck this. I'm going to turn this off. I'm going to go play some Assassin's Creed.
Hell yeah.
I'm going to go kill some kings or some pirates or whatever they're on now.
It's an artistic pursuit in its own right, so I say go with it. Follow your heart.
Well, judging from what I'm seeing in your background, you would know a lot about art. Is that like something that Garfield's, what is his name, Jim?
Oh my God, the guy that, his owner? Isn't he a cartoonist? Yeah, it's so meta. It's like him, right? Like it's him making a cartoon about his cat. I don't know what his name was. I hated.
Wait,
those
was
comics.
He making?
Is it Jim? What is?
Was he a comic maker? What's happening?
Jim, right?
I don't know.
No, glitchy. He was like an artist, I think, or maybe he was an architect.
Yeah, architect, I think.
John. His name was John. His name was John Arbuckle.
Ah,
no, it was not.
I swear,
John
to
Arbuckle.
You.
It was. Oh my God!
And I didn't even Google it. I just thought. And it was Jim Davis was the artist.
Yeah.
Listeners are just screaming at their podcast right now. Just like, this fucking John!
Are you kidding me? Well, I don't know the album yet, but like, I hope the album is so out there, not Garfield related. It's like, less Garfield, more Metallica! Or whatever. Clark, I don't really know you. We just met the other day. I lied to you, Rick. I said my friend.
Yeah.
We met in traffic the other day. I was like, you should be on a podcast. You look like you have some shit to talk about. Clark, what do you teach?
That's such a great origin story.
No, Nick says we met in traffic, but he knows very well that he rear-ended me in a parking lot at Home Depot. That's different than traffic, Nick. That's how we met.
Is that
Remember?
True?
You tore my back bumper off. And you didn't give me your insurance card.
Mm-hmm. And this is, and we're also
that's
talking
incredible.
About sexual things.
So that's
this
actually,
isn't like a car-on-car thing. Yeah. This is man-on-man. I rear-ended him hard.
I am.
Ripped off his bumper. He needs to get a new ass surgically.
Yeah.
Surgically?
Surgically.
Is there a different way?
I'm sure there is.
Prosthetically.
Prosthetically.
Yeah.
Orally. Man, that's not pretty. That's,
No, it doesn't sound good.
Yeah.
I've walked down a deep, dark hole that I don't want to be in anymore. This is just
and I did that day in the Home Depot parking lot.
Yeah, me and Nick have known each other for a while. I don't know, years at this point.
Yes. Yes. What do you teach? I don't know this about you. I don't know basic things about you.
Yeah.
What do you teach?
Okay, so the basic things are, my name's Clarke Andros. I am a educator and a writer, and I do some art stuff as well. And so, yeah, the table you see behind me, that's my drafting table. And so when I make a lot of art, I make it on
drafting.
That. Yeah, drafting. It was my father's.
Isn't that when the car, you drive behind another car so that the wind flies around you and you can go faster?
It's actually exactly what it is. But different.
And you use a table for that.
And you use a table for that, yeah. Yeah, that's my drafting table. I'm just going to skirt past that. I'm sorry. I used the drafting
Good,
table
because it was stupid, Clark, so keep moving on. Thank you.
Yeah, so I do that. I'm a English teacher and a photography teacher at Atascadero High School. So go public education. I've been doing that for a year. And before that, I worked 10 years doing a whole bunch of different jobs. And so, but now I'm a teacher. All grown up.
What would you say is your least favorite job you've ever done?
Ooh, good question.
Thanks, buddy.
Least favorite job.
And don't say blow.
No, that's not the worst. The worst was I was on this maintenance crew in college. So, you know, when you're at your university, people like fix the buildings and stuff. And
okay,
sometimes they pay the college kids to do it. Well, I did that. And they they had way more faith in me than they should have because I didn't know what the hell I was doing. And they asked me to replace all the drywall in this bathroom on campus. And it was huge job by myself.
That is a real job. That is not a, like, yeah, pick up it was the like trash all these, around yeah. the parking
no,
lot. That's a
no. Those are the jobs you're supposed to have. Instead, they're like, oh, you need to go repair the drywall. And they, like, give me all the stuff to do it. And I would go every day. And I swear to God, I went 3 times a week for a month and made 0 improvements on the project and then just quit the job at the end of the semester. They just...
Did they ever come check on it?
No, they never checked my work. And so there is just this college bathroom in shambles. I've ruined it. I've, like, cut away the old drywall...
You did the demolition.
Yeah, so I was like pulling
stuff.
It had leaked and like the drywall got all sopping wet and like I just pulled it all down and then I was like slowly patching it back up every day telling him like, yep, I'm working on it. No improvement in the whole project. Like a whole month's worth of work and then somebody would have just had to come, some other poor college. They're probably still working on that bathroom 8 years later.
Just like he really guy fucked after this the other. Thing up.
Yeah. Just endless.
You flush the toilet and the light flickers.
Endless college kids just repairing this. It's like purgatory for these poor student laborers.
Exactly. It never gets
That's what
done.
Happens. Yeah.
I mean, that's,
when you die, you get sent to an ethereal plane that just consists of a bathroom that is in constant disrepair, and you can never fix it, no matter how often you come back to it.
Oh my god!
And you have to toil at that until you are good enough to get into heaven.
Yeah,
that
sounds that's like what
the
it
plot
was
to a new Jordan Peele movie.
Yeah, it was embarrassing too because I had a little cart. And like a uniform I had to wear, and I, you know, drive by on campus and see my friends and be like, hey, you know, I'm going to work. Like, you know, drive by in the golf cart, and I was just a fraud. Just didn't know what I was doing. Just showing up to my little job to just bang around in a bathroom.
God. Did you ever make it to heaven, or did you just toil that purgatory forever?
Are you still there?
I'm still in my mind. Yes, every day is just another patch of drywall.
That's always such like a weird. If I wasn't really raised religious or anything, but I know a little bit about it. And purgatory, I've always heard, is basically a place that you have to go when you die to work off your sins. Mm-hmm. And then you get to go to heaven. Like if you didn't do enough bad shit to get to hell, you have to do, you know, I don't know, chores or getting
public
punched
service.
Until.
Yeah.
Is that what I don't? Is purgatory like hell for a minute? Like I don't know what purgatory actually is.
I really think it's just. I think it has more to do with like you wade in and atone for yourself on earth. And then I think you're right. I think it's just kind of a waiting period to get into heaven. You got to do some time in purgatory. If you didn't do it right,
yeah,
the
but
first
they never
time.
Explain like what it like. What's the exchange rate? Like, okay, so if I kill somebody, I go to hell, right?
Uh-huh.
Like that's a law,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I kill somebody,
that's
I go to
one
hell.
Of them.
If I never do anything wrong, I go to heaven automatically, right? So what? How much do I have to do to go to purgatory? Mm. Like just one
yeah,
thing
what's
wrong?
The spectrum on there, yeah. What? Yeah, what is that one thing? Like, can I like you know, like do a fender bender? Like, don't leave my information. Is that purgatory or is that kind of like? Hey, you know, slap on the wrist, you know.
They don't like that. You know, they don't love it. They don't love that you did that, but I don't think that's going to save you. I don't know.
Clarke speaks for the holiest of holies.
I was a theology major in college. That was my degree. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, then you are the person to ask about this.
Yeah, well, you know, no, because I was a terrible student. I was taking my whole time trying to fix a drywall bathroom just to pay for the thing.
I was going to say, he wasn't in class. He was fixing this damn drywall.
Fixing the drywall. No, I went to a Protestant theology program. You're talking about Catholicism, 2 different branches of the Christian church. So 1510, Martin Luther slammed a bunch of theses, not feces. He didn't smear some feces. He nailed his theses to a church door in Germany, and he said, no more. That's your history lesson.
Wow. Did Catholic, that rhyme on purpose?
No, but let's edit this in post and
to
say
a
it
door,
did.
And then he said, no more.
Catch that in post. Put a little auto-tune
on it. Yeah,
that
was like a slam poem.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, man. Interesting. Okay.
Wait, so what are some, I want you guys to tell me what some of the music is that you've gotten on here before. Who are the cool kids? And what are the cool kids listening to? I always like to hear about that.
Oh, had Aqua's Barbie Girl.
Yes.
Oh, hell yeah. Okay. Yeah.
We had the Lion King soundtrack, the new one, the one that Beyonce did.
The Lion King soundtrack.
With Childish Gambino and stuff.
We had Scooter, the German DJ from the late 90s.
Okay.
And we had Meatloaf and his son Meatloaf 2. We had Andy Serkis, who plays Gollum in Lord of the Rings.
He did the Machiavelli album by Tupac as Gollum.
Really?
It's revolutionary.
Mm-hmm. That is revolutionary.
Yes.
And and then we did The Blueprint by Jay-Z.
Oh my god.
Which I hope we do someday.
We haven't done any of those.
We haven't done anything. We're not even doing
a podcast. Don't tell them. If you want to know, man, you'll have to listen to the show.
I know.
It hasn't released yet. This episode will be released after it is released, though. The show is out, though. Yes.
Okay, good.
You will, before your episode is out, be able to hear the show. I don't know what solace that will bring you.
None. I can tell you already. It'll bring me nothing.
Yeah.
Now I'm shaking.
I'll say for sure there's nothing been that, like, anything that was released before 2006. Or after 2006, I should say. I meant that. After 2006.
Correct? Nothing has been released after.
So we haven't done anything.
Correct, yeah.
Pre 2006.
Yes, everything has been pre 2006. Yeah. So, like, nothing that's been Migos. Or actually, I take that back too, because we did an EDM episode with an album.
Mm.
Oh, I think that was from 2008.
Yeah.
But, no, it was 2013. It was 2013.
Yeah. But either way, we haven't done anything that's like the super hip. We haven't done like a Megan Thee Stallion or a...
Love her.
K-5. Pop 5? K-pop. Mm.
BTS.
BTS. There it is. Nothing like that.
You seen these BTS stands on the Twitter? They're going crazy. Going crazy posting their K-pop gifs.
Flooding the airwaves. Is K-pop the genre? I'm so confused by this, honestly. Yeah. Clarke, you probably give me. Yeah. We'll have more
Korean. Isn't it Korean pop?
Yeah,
it's huge, man.
Okay,
it's
Korean pop.
The high school kids love it. All my students, when you know, because we do like Zoom calls like this. This is how I teach now. So many of them have like K-pop posters on their wall. They love it.
Really?
The kids love it. You got a niece and nephew, 14 to 15, getting some from K-pop. They love it.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Christmas present, K-pop. Birthday present, K-pop.
This is how I know that I'm not actually in tune with the kids. Like, I felt like I was pretty cool because I like some pretty, you know, new music, but I didn't even know that K-pop was that big.
It's popular, man. They love...
That's amazing.
You know,
that and I feel
it's a total Gen Z vibe.
I feel the genre is, like, laughable, though. Like, I feel like it would be cool to not like it, like, especially in high school. Mm.
I think you're thinking from our perspective in high school, because it was cool to not like things when we were in high school. But now, dude, these kids have like, they get coached in mental health, dude. They're not all fucked up like we were.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I mean? So they're not just going out there to like diss everything. They're like, life is positive. We, you know, it's like.
We actually enjoy things.
Yeah, that's we're awesome. Woke. And they're like, you know, I feel like they can celebrate their own likes and dislikes way more. They can let their freak flag fly.
We're going to have a whole generation of earnest people, and it's going to be a real bummer.
Yeah. Yeah.
Man, we could never, back in our day, there was always some scary jock dude to be like, no.
Yeah,
everything
you
can't like that.
It was all defense mode all the time.
My whole existence is cloaked in sarcasm. Yeah. Exactly.
Oh, 100%. In defense mode and always ready to counterattack. Okay, I will not attack you, but if you bring it to me, then I have to say something. Like, and it was always so mean. Like, you always had to go straight for the testicles, metaphorically or literally.
Right. Yeah. Did you ever get into any actual fights when you were in school, Nick?
Not real fights. Like, I slapped a guy across the face one time, but like that got broken up so quickly. Like, it was like
a slap across a land dispute? What it like, slapping him with a leather glove?
He took my madam, and so I took off my glove and slapped him across the face and said, "I will see you at dawn, sir."
He stiffed you a hay penny on a tea shipment.
Exactly. But no, that was it. And then, like, I'm gonna be super honest, because that's what Gen Z is all about, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that what the students, the kids are teaching us? Like,
is that what they are? They're Gen Z, the 14, 15 year olds?
Is that what they
I think
are?
So. I think they fall into it. Yeah.
Okay.
Millennials and then Gen Z.
We got taken to the principal's office, and I bawled like a baby the whole time. And like, the principal was even like, "You know, it's fine." Like, he's calling me down. He's like, "All that's happening is that, like, you know, at lunch today, you just sit by yourself. That's it."
Yeah.
And it's just like, "I'm so sorry." I'm in fifth grade, too. This isn't like, you know, like, I'm, you know, old enough to at least hold my shit together emotionally, but that's not our generation. We come to find out.
No.
Foreshadowing. And, it was horrible.
I got in a fight with a kid it had to have been third grade, because we were in music class, and, everybody got music stands from the teacher to have your little music book on, so you could play your recorder or play your little instrument while we all clapped along to "Don't Worry, Be Happy" or whatever the fuck we were doing that week.
Mm-hmm. Those were good days.
So one of the music stands had kind of scratched into the back of it a heart, and it said RS plus and some other initials that I do not remember. Mm-hmm. I hadn't made it. My initials are RS, but I had not made it. No one I knew had made it, and it wasn't had no nothing to do with me. Mm. But the kid who was the bully to me saw this thing, and he just went off on a whole, like, making fun of me that I loved something. He didn't even know what it was. It was RS plus CD, you know, like, if it was like that. He was like, "Oh, Rick loves CD. Rick loves CD." And because I was being made fun of for literally liking something that no one knew what it was.
And what had you had
it was
nothing
just
to do
that
with.
I liked something. Nothing to do with it. And so I ran out of the classroom after him, after he walked out, and I jumped on him and I punched him in the head.
Oh, shit,
hell
Rick.
Yeah.
Rick. Don't tell me I like something. Don't tell me I like something, okay?
Oh, my God.
And teacher broke it up right after, or was it just like a hit and a run? Was it a hit and run?
No, it was I jumped on and like knocked him down and punched him in the head a couple of times.
Oh, nice.
Damn.
Well, where is he now? What was his name?
He's dead.
Mm, classic.
I killed him.
Classic bully. Classic elementary, junior high bully. They're all dead.
Come to me. I'll put you in the dirt. You tell me I like something. No, he's probably fine. I don't know. He's probably, you know, pumping somebody's gas somewhere.
Hell yeah. That's what we all want out of our bullies, when in reality they're our banker. They're the guy that owns the mortgage on our house.
It's always like more realistically. Yeah. It's like, they're the landlord of the apartment building. Like, it's
because they've bullied their way to the top of the work pool, too.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
You think it goes away? Like, movies always like depict like the bully as like the fat bald loser or something, and it's like, no, they like just kept that mentality,
they
and they got through their job so much quicker than all of us. Like, they had the balls to tell their boss to fuck off rather than me, who was like, "You know, I'll stay after, don't worry." And now like, who's going? Oh boy, this is a dark window in my life. Have you ever been into a fight, Clark?
No, I'm thankful for that.
You don't look like you've been in a fight.
I was going to say that. You don't look like you've ever been in a fight. You look like Duncan Trussell that was even more chill.
I don't know who Duncan Trussell is.
Well, that's a quick Google search away, my boy. And
we also make our guests do their research. Well, actually, there's only one way to do this. Also, could podcasts have happened without the internet to
No way.
Checking things and stuff? Like, you know, like an argument of like, oh, that wasn't until this year, or like, no, I'm pretty sure, and then like without the internet, just like, oh well, guess we'll never find out.
Unless you,
yeah,
have
none
like
of us has an encyclopedia or anything.
Encyclopedia Britannica, all volumes yeah, on hand. Exactly. Yeah. And
pause
updated.
Recording. I'm gonna call my friend. Just hold on. I think my mom should know. Hold on. Just
I have a
pause
full
recording.
Set of Encyclopedia Britannica, but I'm missing all the vowels and C K Q R S. Well, I have, okay, let me tell you what I do have. I have Z, W, and F.
Exactly. Going into the
only the good,
house,
only the hits.
And
that's
like,
the hits.
Seeing,
yeah.
Seeing the shelf of books is like, really, you have K and T. What was going on here? This is dark.
Yeah, what are you looking up? How much do you love ketamine and tranquilizers that you were that's the two books that you kept?
Okay, MacGyver. Somebody sniffed out a theme. Somebody sniffed out. You got that. Okay, so I'm looking
T
at
thing.
I'm looking at Duncan Trussell, and he fits the bill. White guy, big beard with long hair, classic. It's, we're
and
everywhere.
The kind eyes and just like the yeah. Just yeah, man, the you look like him.
Eyes. That's it. Just kind classic. Eyes. Just
classic.
All my students, all the time. Like sometimes I'll wear my hair down. They're like, "Oh, look, Jesus," and I'm like, "Classic, got me."
Do you tell them that you couldn't be Jesus because you're not black?
Yeah, I tell them that all the time. We actually did that. We had a whole art lecture on the whitification or whitewashing of Jesus, and they still make the jokes.
Wow, damn.
Yeah.
Well, at least there's some good teaching going on in the educational system.
Yeah.
That's what
Once
we
again,
need these
that
days.
That was not
too
the
much.
Art class that I took in high school. Yeah. We took, let's draw your dream bedroom.
So you teach art?
I teach English and art. I teach
yes.
both.
Over yeah. over Zoom. Yeah. I would imagine English is easier to teach over Zoom than art is.
So much easier. So, but I do photography, so it works because all the kids have nice. They have nicer phones than I do. So they, you know, oh, they just right. go out and they take the pictures and stuff. But God, man, it's miserable having to do a whole year of teaching art via Zoom. It's brutal.
Yeah.
All right, and then you got to move your your camera yeah. over. Okay. Well,
well, closer, and I'm like,
Scotty,
it's backwards.
Hold it closer.
It's backwards, bud.
Oh yeah, everything's backwards. Yeah. You can switch that in Zoom. You can change that.
Yeah, I'm sure you can. But you saw how long it took me to get on Discord today. You think I'm going to go into the deep parts of my computer to figure that one out?
You're great. You did a great job, and you can't.
I was
you
almost
got here
stranded
and you made it
by myself.
Yes.
You pulled yourself up by your bootstraps.
Yeah, John
and
Wayne
you brought
did.
Us a great album. Are you excited about the album that you brought today?
I love the album that I brought today. I love
great.
It. It's one of my favorite albums of my whole life.
Oh, that's nice. So good to
nice.
Hear.
Yeah.
Well, let's take a break real quick, and then we will see what that album is.
Sweet.
We'll be right back with Clarke Andros and Spin Doctors when we return. Hey guys, thanks for listening. Just wanted to talk to you real quick about a cool thing that we're doing. We are coming up on our 10th episode, and we wanted to do maybe a cool little special after that, maybe where we talk about some albums that you guys like. So we thought it'd be fun to have you guys send in some albums that mean a lot to you, you know, something that you listened to in high school or at a young age and really has a special place in your heart, and send it in to us at, you know, on Twitter, Instagram, email, and we'll talk about it on the show. We'll kind of compile a list of a few different albums and kind of quickly go through them and talk about them and make jokes and fun times. So if that seems like something you want to be involved with, send us an email or a message or a carrier pigeon or like a smoke signal. Or if you could hire one of those airplane skywriters, we definitely accept that. But get a message to us somehow and we will talk about your album. All right, that's it. Back to the show. And we're back. We're here with artist, music lover, musician, teacher, educator. He's the educator of our students.
And that's why we need him as a teacher, because we are education
I need
is not working it did. for us here in our 30s. So please,
no, man,
teach
if
the
I
future.
Could have had you in my classroom, I would have molded you into perfect pupils. Look at you two. Just all
we could have been
wide-eyed. Yeah.
I could have been a contender.
Yeah. You could have Marlon Brando'd all the way through my class.
Now I just look like late stage Marlon Brando.
The Marlon Brando that snuck off with Elizabeth Taylor and Michael Jackson on 9/11.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, that's like one of my favorite stories of all time.
I could have eaten a Snickers.
Yeah.
No, I am not familiar with this story of Marlon Brando, Michael Jackson, Elizabeth Taylor sneaking off during 9/11.
Yeah, it was like, I don't know if it
Rick,
was,
are you aware of this?
Yeah, of course. Everybody knows about it.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Well, I feel
totally,
bad.
Totally, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember it was yesterday.
Okay, now you're a goddamn liar. Yeah. Clarke, tell us the story.
Now, so, I mean, I just looked it up, right? And it's like the mystery, it's, let's see, Washington Post, Vanity Fair, they're all talking about The Guardian. And so, says the mystery of that Michael Jackson, Elizabeth Taylor, Marlon Brando post 9/11 road trip. I don't know. You got to read up, dude.
Well, that's okay. It? That's all it says? Okay.
Oh,
well.
I thought you just kind of knew it off the top of your head. I wasn't, you know, just.
No, it was, he just knew of the legend.
Yeah.
Damn, well, that's one car I would never want to be in.
No.
You wouldn't
want to
be. Oh, that would be a pretty a loud car.
Ugh. Can we stop again?
Yeah.
No.
That's a streetcar named Perspire.
Dude, that dude was probably so sweaty. Speaking Elizabeth Taylor probably sweat bullets too.
Oh, yeah. And just no Michael doubt. just wearing.
Michael Jackson, I don't think could sweat. I think they had sealed all of his pores shut.
Poor guy.
That's good. I like that.
Speaking of musicians, speaking of music artists, let's do it. Let's get to the album. Every
all
week
right.
on the show, we present an album, or we have the guest present an album. You take your pick. You know, whatever you want to say. You know,
pick it.
I like
pick,
to say
pick
that the guest
finger
chooses
pick
the album.
It if you like. Yes.
It could be an album very close to their heart, very near and dear to them. It could be an album with good memories associated with it. Any album, any topic. They bring us an album and go over it. And this week's album, Clarke, what have you brought for us?
I've brought for us the 1999, entered at number one on the Billboard charts, won 2 Grammys for Best Performance by a Vocalist in a Country Duo or Group, and Best Country Album.
Right,
it's the album Fly by Dixie Chicks, 1999 release date. One of the best albums of all time. Okay, I don't think you guys are ready for
FKA Dixie Chicks.
Formerly known as, you're right, the Chicks now, because they're so woke that
they
said we're dropping
woke.
The Dixie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they did.
Wow.
Gotta love it. Some people might ask, why didn't they do it sooner? But I mean,
yeah, why did it take so long?
Why did it take
so long?
But anyway, better late than never.
Yeah, we like their art, so we let them slide, I guess.
Also, fuck it, Lady Antebellum, even more after trying to take another artist's name and just more white privilege that it just like anyway just I just want to get into it. Didn't like it. Lady
yeah, we'll be Lady A. Oh,
with.
there already is a Lady A. No, we'll be that.
No, that's
we'll
ours.
Be that. It's ours now.
That's what we're
it's
gonna.
It's ours
be.
Now. But I've
Excuse
had it for
me.
20 years. Okay, it's gross.
Gross.
Ew. Move on.
And I'm,
come
and
on.
I'm
it's
quoting
ours now.
Gross. End quote.
Hmm. All right, so what do you want to know about Fly?
Okay, real quick, did not get a Dixie Chicks fan vibe from you.
Yes, this is the biggest surprise.
Yes,
I fully
was
expected
something different. What were you expecting, Rick?
Oh, I fully expected like a Not a Rasta album. I fully expected it could have been it could have been anything. It could have been Band of Horses. It could have been
no, dude, no, Band of Horses, the dude sounds the same from start to finish, track after track, album after album. The reverb's turned up, his voice is soft and soulful, but it's the same every song. not banned to horses, but
I'm not going to disagree with you.
Was that too harsh? Was that too harsh?
No, absolutely. No,
it's
I'm
more
not in the
impressive
band.
That you were just ready for it. I'm not in the band.
Yeah. Do you guys want to know what my other choices were? This is what
yeah,
I was debating.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Please do, yes.
Yeah.
What were you kind of going between?
Calexico's Garden Ruin. The band Calexico, I don't know if you've ever heard of them.
I've never heard of that ever.
Two-man group from Tucson. They have like 30 studio albums. They've been playing since the 90s. Jeez. It is alternative southwestern country. They sing in, they'll sing in French, Spanish, English. It's two white guys out of Tucson. They're so good. Favorite band of all time.
Wow. Interesting. Wow.
Yeah. But they didn't win this. But the chicks still beat them out. And the other one was In Rainbows by Radiohead. Because that's the album.
Yep.
Nope. But that's a new one for me. I came into Radiohead late.
Oh, okay, really?
I am,
okay.
My genetics make it so that I was just predisposed to love Radiohead from a younger age, but it didn't happen. I came into it later.
We have the same genes,
Clark.
I'm on it with you.
Yeah,
I too was late to it. My genes was not well developed till later in life.
Yeah.
And I still haven't fully
taken in
Rainbows.
We make a threes company because I got into Radiohead late too. I only got into them through listening to other bands that covered them.
Ah,
so, there we go.
But that's not the out. That's not the band.
That's
when
not
did
it.
You
it doesn't
hear,
matter.
Of the Dixie Chicks.
Okay, so I grew up here in I live in Santa Margarita. That's where we are right now, and. God, man, country music growing up, that was all we listened to in the car, family road trips, and so I listened to a lot of Dixie Chicks, and, you know, it's so funny because as a kid, like, nobody wanted to admit that they liked the Dixie Chicks, and I'll admit it, like, I would not have been a self-professed fan. Right?
Yes,
like, people
yes, going back to what it was like being a kid in our generation,
yeah.
You loved them. You
yes,
see, this
yes.
is so.
Everybody
this
was making
is
fun
so
of
our generation right now. Exactly. You secretly love them, and you're shitting on them to all your friends.
Yeah, to all your friends, kids these days. Like, you're telling me I could have been into makeup tutorials if I was born now? That's awesome. Like, you want to be into that? That's sweet. You know what
I
mean? I
want to know how to do a smoky eye.
Yeah, I got a kid that likes to watch videos of, like, somebody cutting soap with a sharp knife. Sick. He would have been crucified in our school day.
Yeah, can you imagine bringing up Dr. Pimple Popper in ninth grade?
Hey, oh, yeah. Exactly, right?
Dr. Pimple Popper. Yeah, yeah. It's
oh
like,
my
those,
God.
That's not the stuff you should have... And I was so jealous. He would have been crucified, and it's horrible to say, but it's
it
true.
Would have followed
like,
him forever.
On.
Like... We would have like ran into that kid at the bar last year or something or whatever, mm-hmm. and been like, "Oh, hey, there's Mike. Remember him? He watched videos of cutting soap." And we would probably reference that to him, be like, "Hey,
yeah.
even though this was like 20 years ago, still watching those fucking videos?" It's just like, oh,
videos
man.
Of soap.
Oh, we got the soap boy. What's up, soap boy?
Exactly. Oh, it's
yeah.
Soapy. What's up, Soapy? It's like, dude, I'm married.
Always
with
watching
kids now,
soap
please.
On his phone. Don't drop your phone.
He's
don't
like,
drop
well, Clark,
your phone in the shower.
Clark, I'm your financial advisor. It'd be cool if you showed me some respect. I'm like, your portfolio at this point. And let me tell you, bud, you didn't diversify much, and you have no money. You lost it all on Bitcoin. All right, you should have sold. You're the worst client I've ever had. And that's the kid, right? That's the kid that
yep.
liked to watch those videos because he was like, you know, in touch with himself.
Exactly.
Instead, we just all suppressed it and pushed it deep in our guts.
And now we just do podcasts
yeah.
and
yeah.
teach
and
youth.
Say, like,
so,
yeah.
shit on
sorry,
him.
Kids.
yeah,
so Dixie Chicks is part of the fabric, mm-hmm. right? It's like, they're huge. They're like one of the biggest groups. But
absolutely.
Let me tell you, I loved them when I was a kid, went away from them for a long time, and then as of recent, in the last like 3 years, got back into Indigo Girls and Dixie Chicks as just like feminine, forward, badass lyrics, music composition.
Yeah.
Like, I just heard a couple interviews with them, with the gals from Indigo Girls, and I was like, oh my God, I didn't know how like multifaceted and like deep their story was. And then I started like learning more about 9/11 and post 9/11 America, and realized that like the Dixie Chicks are a huge part of the resistance to to the reaction to 9/11, to the Bush administration, like, and then I learned all that
Texas.
Stuff about them.
Yeah,
they were
yeah.
from Texas, spoke out against the war in Iraq, you know, said it wasn't justified, and then like people were having parties where they literally bulldozed over all their CDs and like burnt their merchandise in public
wow.
squares. and they're still prolific. Like, they're still good. And I'm like, I didn't realize till I was older. I was like, damn, that took a lot of courage. Mm-hmm, the Dixie mm-hmm. Chicks are tough, man.
Yeah,
they're
we were too young at that time to understand, like, because I remember it in the news, but, like, I was just kind of like, it just going over the head. Like, yeah. That is just not in the realm.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
Like, now looking back and, like, watching, like, documentaries about that time, I'm like, oh, damn, like, that was a big deal. And, like, that's super badass of them to, like, step up like that. So, I mean.
Yeah. I always trip out on that, man. Like, I was talking to somebody the other day, and we were talking about cancel culture, and, like, if you look back, cancel culture existed with all these conservative people that hated that the Dixie Chicks did, like George Bush. Like, they literally destroyed stuff. They rioted in the street.
The idea of cancel culture has always existed. People have tried to ban books for hundreds of years.
Yeah.
And so
they
try
to spin it as this new thing.
That's we don't like that thing that you are doing, so we are going to. Yeah. And has it been used improperly? Of course it has. Banning books and stuff. Has it been used properly? Of course it has. Mm-hmm. Deplatforming racists. Like, it's absolutely... these are everything can be used for a good or a bad thing. I do have a question though. Do you think that the Indigo Girls missed an opportunity to call themselves the Indigo Girls?
The Indigo Girls.
Speak on that. Discuss.
I think I don't know. Yes, obviously, because
Thank
I
you.
Love
I
to combine
that.
Things. That's all I have to say. They missed a big opportunity.
I have a confession to make. Yes. I am a self-professed hater of country music.
Cool. Okay. I love that. I love that for you.
It's
Which
so
means
Clark, I love this.
That the pressure is on to convert this country hater. Mm-hmm. But I honestly think that if there's a country band that has the possibility of doing it, it is a country band that is a progressive, not bunch of dudes talking about trucks and beer. That is gonna pull the trigger for me, not to reference another thing that they like to talk about.
All right, step into my world, because this is what I love.
Yeah.
Pre-9/11 country and post-9/11 country are in two different hemispheres, brother.
Ooh.
Yes.
They are completely different things.
That makes sense.
Country pre-9/11 was way more about songwriting, craft, melody, composition, catchy lyrics that everybody could get behind. And then afterwards, the hyper-patriotism and the playing into this idea of conservatism across America, while weirdly mixing in the objectification of women at every chance.
Yes. Yep.
And helping the car industry and a bolster of sales to trucks and SUVs. I don't know. It's weird. The post-9/11 country is terrible, man. It's so bad. I get it.
Well, that's good
to know.
Okay.
And this is 2 years before, so this is going to be the good, like, this is before America was fractured into good and bad country artists.
Yes. Mm. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. It's a great album. I think you guys are going to dig it.
Well, let's get in it.
So did you hear this album when it came out?
Mm. Yeah, I definitely would have. I would have been 19. I would have been 7 years old, definitely. Yeah.
Okay.
Listen to the country station all the time. 98.1 K-Jug, brother. Come on. You know?
Yeah, sorry. I didn't, what did we listen to? 96.1 Sly 96 I listened to.
Oh,
dude,
Sly
I was
96.
About to say Sly 96.
Good times.
Yeah, rest in peace. Such a good radio station.
What was it? Kiss 106.1? I think that was a radio station.
106.1 was, or was it like Wild 106?
It went from Kiss to Wild.
Yeah.
It went from Kiss. It was originally Kiss 106, and then it switched to Wild, and so it was, we used to Kiss, and now we're going fully Wild.
Oh,
yeah,
my God.
I remember
like
that.
Every parent was like, what is about to happen right now? Switching the station.
Somebody pulled home a paycheck from that line right there. We used to Kiss, but now we're Wild. It's just like,
brilliant.
Right on. Kids are getting a trampoline this Christmas. Hell yeah.
Have you ever seen the Chicks live?
No, it is on my list.
Oof. Yeah.
Big time. Oh, yeah. I was actually getting ready for this. I was watching live performances on YouTube of them, and chills. Mm. Can't see it, but chills.
Okay.
They're still there.
Pre-COVID, were they
touring
substantially?
Yeah, they started, they I don't know if they've been, yeah, they toured recently. They just came out with an album, but they were in like a bluegrass band that did like the county fair circuit in Texas before they ever became the Dixie Chicks.
Oh.
So they're like super accomplished musicians. So like they're really gnarly.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, they play all their own.
Yeah, there's a really good fiddle
like
player,
band.
Right? One of them's like a
yep,
badass fiddle player.
Yeah, the fiddle player's super good. And yeah, she's super good at the fiddle. And then the one gal plays banjo and the main singer plays, she plays guitar and sings. She's super good.
Man, that's so
cool. And she
cool.
has short hair. Natalie Maines, Emily Robison, and Marty Seidel.
Mm. Oh, you know, names. Oh, you got the names. We got to give credit where credit is due. Yeah, absolutely.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, big time.
But so have you ever seen, what bands do have you generally seen? Like, are you a big concert goer?
I'm a big concert goer.
Yeah.
Obviously not anymore, but it spans the gamut. Been going to, usually go to Hardly Strictly Bluegrass Festival every year.
Oh, yeah, I've
can.
Heard very good things about that.
Yeah, super fun. And so love me some Americana, alternative country. But then also love, what did I just say? Before the shutdown, I saw Father John Misty with Jason Isbell at Santa Barbara Bowl.
Oh, nice.
Oh, man, I was supposed to go to that show, yeah.
Yeah, saw Soccer Mommy with Casey Musgraves in Los Angeles.
Oh, that's a good
one. I just found out about Soccer Mommy.
Okay, Soccer Mommy, she is future president of the United States. That girl is so sick, dude. The
I don't know about
hand.
I don't know anything about her really. I just heard one of her songs.
She's awesome. Yeah, get into it.
All
She's
right.
got a super fun band. They're all young dudes, just really good musicians. They're fun.
Dude, that's like the new music that I'm into. I don't know about all this K-pop and BTS. I don't know if I can get on board with that this generation with that, but I can get on board with Soccer Mommy and all that fun stuff. I've been listening to Courtney Barnett. Courtney Barnett's great.
Yes.
She's got that Australian accent. She's like,
yes.
I did the laundry. I put detergent.
Is that how you get into that accent with laundry?
Yeah.
Laundry.
Yeah, I just think about that. Yeah, she's great. She just came to Slow not too long ago.
Oh, really?
Oh, she did. Yeah.
Yeah, she played a show. It sold out at the Fremont.
Of course it did. Yeah.
I went, I saw Mo at the Fremont. That was a good show.
Who?
Mo. It's a jam band. That's what I'm a big jam band.
Oh
guy.
Hell yeah!
He's a Fish
like
guy.
Like Grateful Dead kind of stuff.
Yeah, Fish. Like I've seen Fish.
That's
like,
that's
his. 30
that's
times
his,
or
yeah.
so.
Hell yeah! Okay. What about Dave Matthews Band?
I do like Dave Matthews Band. I haven't. I've never seen them. But I am a fan.
I got some big DMB fans in the family.
Yeah.
A lot of concerts. mine and Nucky's mutual friend Jake Vukovic. Big Dave Matthews Band fan. Been to a lot of shows.
I didn't know that.
Oh, I just outed him to you, dude.
Holy shit.
I had
no,
they
he's
went
been
to
multiple
shows growing
shows?
Up. Oh, yeah. The
Whoa.
Parents are super into it.
Damn.
And he's not to be, man. The whole band's just ripping. They had a fiddle player.
Yeah. They had a fiddle player. Any band with a fiddle player, automatically amazing.
Bring it.
Obviously rules. Dixie Chicks are up there, dude.
Dixie Chicks, Dave Matthews Band, and Yellow Card. Come at me. Top three bands
Hell
with a fiddle player.
Okay. Dude.
Oh, yeah. Yellow Card had the electric fiddle player, didn't they?
The guy who looked like he wanted to be the bass player in No Doubt. They're like, the four strings, but plucking them? Nah. Put that up to the shoulder, buddy, and let's get rocking.
You can have a tiny bass.
You can have that little tiny
but
bass.
But some No Doubt. Has anybody brought a No Doubt album on here?
No.
No.
Doubt.
Oh, my God.
I almost did that exact same thing.
No Doubt.
When I was in a band, we covered a No Doubt song. We covered
song?
Just a Girl.
Oh,
see, yes. I was just, the friend we were referring to, Jake, I was just telling him that I'm Just a Girl would be a solid cover for like a nasty
fun.
Punk band, you know? But like, you know, just a bunch of guys singing it. Or like a I don't know, I'm a big fan of the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, and that lead singer, she's gnarly. She's like a performer. I saw her perform once and she took, how did this go? Yeah, she stuck the microphone down her shirt, unzipped her pants, stuck the microphone through the hole through her pants, and then started windmilling it around, and then like just was yelling at the same time. Like, she's wild, like one of those like kind of performers that like pits the blanket on her and just starts crawling around the stage, just going, but like the band is just like fucking tight and just killing it and stuff. But like you're like, this is art. This is beautiful. This
yeah, makes sense. It's performance yeah. art in a band. Yes.
Okay, I love that. I love that. But yes. I saw them perform on some late night show a long time ago, and I really dug it.
Yeah, they're great. They're great. I love them. But we don't care about yes. We care about the chicks.
We care about Dixie Chicks.
Dude, chicks.
What's so funny? We keep hitting back on this theme of female-led bands. Mm-hmm. So many good ones that we just referenced. And goddamn, that's why I had to change it up. I listened to enough dead white guys, pouty little white guys, you know? Life is hard. We're going to coal mine. They've never worked in a fucking coal mine. It's all a ruse, right? Their dad was a doctor.
Yep.
They were on the varsity sports team, but they happened to have a silky smooth voice. And so they got to sing all the hits. But no, female-led bands are where it's at. And
there
so,
it is. Yes,
I love
and especially
album.
Like recently, I like this, the resurgence almost, or like the allowance now of female empowerment in music is getting so explicit now, you know, like, Billie Eilish and Megan Thee Stallion and all these people are just like Lizzo. They're just so like empowering and stuff, which is
great.
You know, I'm very, very for it, but it's also tough to sing along to as a dude.
Nah, man, you just gotta let it. And you know what? They're all so lucky to have three white dudes like us talking about their careers on a podcast.
Well, at least we're not criticizing them. Like, you know what Lizzo could do differently.
Yeah, right.
Just all of us, like,
I'm just in awe.
We're like, hell yeah, we love it.
If anything, it's their way of knowing that they made it. That it's like, awesome. We got three white guys on a podcast talking about how great we are. We made it. It's like, I don't know if you guys watched that show Atlanta.
Oh, God, love Atlanta. Oh, I was going to say, just what they need is three dudes that are in the midst of existential crises giving them shout-outs.
Yes.
Like,
oh, yeah.
That's how you know you made. The guys that grew up, like we said, in the generation where everybody eviscerated each other over any slight like or dislike.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. I have a green screen behind me because this wall has holes in it from when I was a teenager throwing knives at it to deal with my stress. So I have a green screen now that covers that up so that that's not visible on camera.
I mean, battle rapping was like, I feel like was at the peak of popularity when we were in that middle school range, and it is because the whole basis of it was just tearing apart the other person, and our generation was like, yes, I connect with that. Let's make fun of the other person as much as possible and get really deep and dark into it when we can.
Mm-hmm. We're all fucked.
Yeah, battle rapping is just like rhyming bullying. And I'm for it.
Exactly. It's like, man, he's mean and he has great flow. How am I supposed to combat this?
Oh, God. Nothing worse than a bully with natural rhythm.
Oh, I know. God, they're truly the worst. I hate when you have to give credit to somebody that you hate. You're just like... It sucks.
Oh,
God. All right, let's take another break. And then when we get back, we will start the album. We'll be right back.
I have seen like probably about 50 different memes with Bernie Sanders sitting in the lawn chair at the inauguration today, and I'm not close to being over it. I honestly am not. I've seen so many iterations of it, and I'm loving it. Right here, I don't know if you can see, this is a picture of him sitting next to Ben Roethlisberger on the bench after
so
they
perfect.
Lost the playoff game.
When they're all sitting there.
I mean, it's just like...
It was so sad. They were crying.
That's so funny.
They lost the game.
The internet wins again.
I always pick the wrong pictures to make a meme out of. Like, I've done so many that, like, there's like the popular image will come across. I'm like, oh, I snatch it up and I make a meme out of it and I post it. And a couple of them have done okay, but never is it like something that really takes off.
Yeah, me neither. The few I've tried, I thought I was hitting on something. And also, and they didn't hit. And also, I play a little game with myself when, like, I'm watching, like, a big thing, like the inauguration, a Super Bowl. You know, like a big event type of thing. I like to call out moments. I'm like, that's going to be a meme I see everywhere. And I never do. I can't even call them right.
Oh,
so
really?
I have no right into
making
them.
Yeah, I don't know how people see them. Like, yeah. Like the perfect one gets picked somehow. I don't know how it happens. Mm-hmm. Like, the perfect little footage of something will get hit. Like, there's a... Welcome back to Spin Doctors. We're back. There's a video of a deer, and it's, like, walking around this backyard, and the intro to...
In the Air Tonight by
In the Air Tonight Peter by Frampton. Phil Collins, yes.
Oh, is Phil playing. Collins, yeah.
And it's like you know, going through all the singing and kind of the synthesizers, and then when it gets to the drum breakdown, the doo 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 doo, it cuts out and it's the deer tripping over all of this lawn equipment and it's going and it's just making a bunch of sound. And somebody made it into that thing, and it's the perfect little video.
I trip out on that all the time, man. There are just an army of people that are just for the chaotic good that is the internet. They just live to feed it. They are just stoking the fire, just pouring more coal in all the time. And they're just scouring the internet, watching videos, finding embarrassing photos of people. And, like, if they full-time job. If they stop, the world is going to end.
Oh, 100%. Let's be honest. Those videos has gotten us through this pandemic more than anything else, for real. Yeah,
sweet.
Like, I've
Lord.
Had multiple yes. thoughts during yes. this pandemic of, like, during, like, the Spanish flu. It's like, what the fuck did they do? Like we have Disney Plus. Yeah. We got Xbox. We got books. They have books too, but you know what I'm saying. Like,
they have books too.
They danced the Charleston, goddamn it. That's what they did.
Seven books at the time, okay? We have millions. They had like seven tops, depending on where they were located.
And three of them were the Bible.
And I just don't understand what people did. So I'm very thankful for technology, for Discord, things like this that we can still communicate. And so.
We'd be here making corn husk dolls or something. You know?
I mean, we would just we'd be here, seriously, farming and fucking our wives and making children that we can't feed.
Yeah, yep. We're like perfecting the loom, which would be a cool skill, but like that's like all you had, right?
That's a great band name.
Loom?
The loom? Perfecting the loom.
Oh, perfecting the loom. I played a show in Chicago one time, or Springfield, Illinois, and the band I played with was this group called Film Loom, like FILMLOOM from Detroit. They were so good, and I looked forever and ever after, and I think they disbanded. Mm-hmm. I got to see them at the show. It's like a random venue in somebody's basement, and they were the best band, man. They were so good.
They're always
that's
the best
how I feel
band,
about my band,
very
man.
Common,
we were so good.
Common tale. Yeah, that's everyone's band that didn't make it. Let's be honest. I love it. I'm supportive, and I believe in everyone. But like, everyone's band that didn't make it.
Come on, man.
We were the real deal, man. You had no idea, man. We just really had it. But
I could have been a real bass player.
I had a streak for a while where I would quit a band and they would like get a record deal immediately after I left, and it
holy
like
shit.
Twice in a row, and I was
like a real good luck Chuck thing.
Yeah, and I was really, like, oh, so I get what the problem was. That's very loud and clear. I should become a writer.
I should do maybe I should get anything away. Else.
Yeah, maybe I should. You know what? I guess I'll become a dishwasher. That's one of my jobs right after. I mean, it like happened twice, and I was like, okay.
Yeah,
writing's
twice,
on the
okay.
wall. That hurts.
Oh my god.
Can't be in a band.
Oh,
yeah.
What did you play in these bands?
I played banjo in both.
Oh,
like,
cool.
Banjo, guitar, and sang. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's an instrument I've always been interested in learning.
It made sense that the banjo was the one to. That probably didn't need to be in the band.
Yeah, of course. You know what our band, you know, there's only a couple songs we need the tinny piercing droll of a banjo. Yeah. Oh, let's make the audience's ears bleed. No, we'll cut the banjo.
Besides, no band will ever make the banjo cool.
And that was it. They didn't even replace you with another banjo player. They just got rid of the banjo entirely. They're just like, no, we don't need this at all.
No,
ticket sales are plummeting. We can't book any venues. Get rid of the banjo player.
They're interested until we say banjo. Yeah.
They're loving it until the banjo case gets brought out. And
yeah, exactly.
The same question
like,
is, what's that? Oh.
Oh. Okay. Oh, another Mumford and Sons clone.
Yeah. So we don't get to play?
Oh, okay, so he's white, he has a beard, he wears blue jeans, he's got leather boots. Oh, what's that I see? A cotton Henley underneath his denim jacket?
Is he wearing a plaid shirt?
Oh, a plaid shirt? Okay, I know exactly what I'm getting. It's so nice to live in a predictable world.
Here, you guys can still have your drink tickets. Just fuck off out of here.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm sure that was never said to this week's artists. I'm sure the chicks were great immediately. But this is what okay, so this album is Fly from the Dixie Chicks.
Fly.
What this came out in 1999. So do you know which album, like how late into their career
Where are we
this
there?
Was?
Yeah.
So it late into their career, no. I think it's actually kind of let me see. I have their discography up right here.
All right, so I got it here.
Oh good.
So their first album came out in 1990.
Oh wow, they've been around.
So
holy
two,
crap.
Three, four, five. So this is their fifth album.
Okay. Damn.
Wide
okay.
Open Spaces would have been the other big one that I listened to as a kid growing up.
Yeah. Mm.
Is that the Chicks too? Is that the Chicks, Wide Open Spaces?
Yeah. Wide Open Spaces.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's
cool,
them.
Cool.
Yeah. That was one of their big ones. And then there was the hiatus after 9/11 for a little bit.
Obviously. Yeah.
Because they did one immediately in 2002 and then they got torn to shreds. 2006. Mm-hmm. And then 2020, they did take a 14-year break. Woof.
Yeah.
Damn.
So I was wrong. It's kind of late career, actually.
Well, I guess, yeah. I mean, it's late in their discography, but it's, you know, 9 years after after their first album, as opposed to 14 years after their last album.
Mm, yeah.
People
so it is,
very
it is
aware
like,
of them
you know,
at this
more
point.
Middle.
Yeah. Very popular.
Exactly.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. They're huge at this point.
I actually have a t-shirt from the Fly Tour. Right here.
Oh, really?
Oh. He's ready tonight. I love it.
See?
Oh, wow.
Hell
there
yeah.
They are. They're all jammed in a drain pipe. You know? Isn't that fun? That shoot looks fun, doesn't it?
Yep. The drain pipe on the Fly album tour sure makes sense. Yep.
Anything for the art.
Tour 2000. Art, yeah. Man. You know, my mother-in-law bought this shirt for me for Christmas. That shows you
this last Christmas?
Two Christmases ago.
Oh, awesome. Damn.
Oh, wow,
so this
okay.
is a thing. Wow, okay. Yeah. Good to know.
Well, what's funny is I had asked for a Indigo Girls t-shirt, but she got the two mixed up because they're all in a particular genre. She probably, you know, she consulted her one friend, Tammy. You know the one.
Yeah.
You know mom's friend Tammy.
Yep.
You know her.
Or a Kelly.
And that's
Tammy
who
or
she
a
consulted.
Kelly.
Or a Kelly. Tammy or Kelly. Yeah. She consulted. She got bad intel, but it actually ended up being great intel because now I have my Dixie Chicks t-shirt and I love it. So.
Well, she knew you would like it either way.
Yeah. I got a type.
All right. Well, let's go ahead and get into it. This is Fly. This is from 1999. So, the first track off of this album, do you remember anything about this particular track?
Ready to Run?
Yeah.
I just remember listening to a lot growing up, and then it's been one that I listened to a lot and sing in the car.
Yeah.
And then this is one of the ones I was listening to a live cut of earlier today, and it was unreal.
All right, so well, let's get into it. This is Ready to Run.
There it is. Ooh.
This sounds like the beginning to a Lord of the Rings, like going into Hobbiton.
That Celtic, it's got that Celtic flair that we all love.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
Because, you know, Irish people, we love Irish people.
See, this doesn't sound like when I picture country music, this doesn't sound like it, you know?
Yeah.
I picture, like, I can't even name a real Kenny Chesney or whatever, you know? Like, my truck, my wife, my Coors Light, and I have
you're
a dog named Taurus.
You're thinking Florida Georgia Line,
yeah,
right. Luke Bryant,
yep,
right. Yeah, yeah, that's who you're thinking of.
Yeah, but this, I mean, like, I can see that it has the country kind of sound to it in I don't know their accents and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But it's got more complex songwriting than when I picture country.
Mm-hmm. Oh my god! Yeah, I know. Like one of the last songs on the album is written by Jim Lauderdale and Buddy Miller, and they do a Patty Griffin song and a Daryl Scott song. So they do like these great songwriters on their album.
Okay,
but they
make cool.
It, like, trendy. Yeah.
Oh, very.
Are those
nice.
People you're
love
familiar
it.
With?
No.
Yeah. No.
Come on, you guys.
Oh, no, I know. Well, I know.
We're not country people.
Wait, what?
I mean,
that's right.
Patsy Cline. Did you say Patsy Cline? Because I know
Patsy
Cline.
Patty Griffin, who's
Patty Griffin?
Meg
Griffin?
Patty Griffin. Who's Meg Griffin? No, that's the girl from that cartoon, isn't it?
Wait, like
American,
the Griffin,
American
like the
mom.
Like the mythical beast?
What are you talking about?
Harry Potter's
a Griffin,
house.
The mythical beast.
No, you two are talking about different things right now. The mythical creature, lion slash dragon thing. That
yeah.
is a griffin.
Okay. I think we're talking about the same thing here. Pretty sure.
Good God. That digressed quickly.
That song seems like a fun like album opener, too. That was fun. I like that.
Yeah.
When I first started by saying, oh, I hate country, I think that... it came across as like, oh shit, this is gonna be a challenge, and like by the first song I'm already like, this is not bad.
Like, this isn't gonna be
the power of chicks, my brother.
Yeah, man.
That sounds like a hardcore chicks fan at the front row of the concert.
Just
and you have someone like Rick
throw my hands up like that
and this,
be like come on.
Exactly, like Rick is in
come
the
on, ladies.
In the
I'm
audience.
Not gonna call him into an encore by myself. Let's go, ladies. Come on.
Oh, that's the power of the chicks,
can
man.
We get some screams? Yeah. You're at the chick show. It's the energy of the chicks, ladies. Get out of your seats. Let's go. That's me.
That's awesome. This
I
is
don't
if
remember
I've...
jack shit about this song. I'll
really,
tell you that.
You have nothing
no,
about
don't
this?
Don't remember it at all.
I mean, that sometimes those that means it's like a hidden gem that you forgot about. You're like, oh, yeah, this song. I love it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's figure it out. This is If I Fall, You're Going Down With Me.
Okay. This is,
yeah, this sounds more like country
than
I would assume
that
like
I'm
it's country.
Associated with, yeah.
Oh, see, no, this is a great ooh. Song.
See, I like her voice. A good country singer has some of the best singing capabilities of any genre, you know?
You like that snare, too, don't you? The tight snare.
Nice tight
snare.
Yeah, this is, I mean... It definitely... I can see how Florida Georgia Line or, you know, all that stuff grew from this and took the sounds of it and then turned it into something that is unpalatable. But this is like, this is
it's a good
it's
song,
got
right?
Pop, like feel. Pop music.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
No,
exactly.
It's funny because I was just doing some research on this song and it ends up, it's on a compilation called Music to Love Your Cousin By. And it's like the third track on that album. And I just thought that I missed that release. And there's Music to Love Your Cousin By volumes 1 through 7.
Oh my god.
And that's
dear
just so
god.
Funny because I feel like that'll be a good way to track the progress.
I'm sure Loving Your Cousin has been going
should
on
we,
for generations,
should,
let alone volumes.
Oh yeah.
Should we start that album, that compilation album? That seems like, remember how people used to make money just off compiling other people's music and releasing it on the TV?
Now that's what I call music.
Why am I working? Why am I not doing this? Music to Love Your Cousin By.
Freedom Rock Volume 19.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, but this, I don't know, it sounds like pop music. It doesn't sound, this. Yeah. I don't hate this at all.
Okay, well wait for the next one, because this one... Prepare to be swept off your feet.
Oh yeah, is this your favorite track on the album?
It's one of my favorite tracks on the album.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. This is Cowboy Take Me Away. That's something I would say.
Yeah, this is.
I would say that to a cowboy.
Yeah. The way the guitar is starting already sounds like the song title. Like, of course, Cowboy Take Me Away is going to be a very sentimental. You got that fiddle, sentimental song. How can you not, like, have... I mean, that's a country go-to, is a fiddle on a ballad.
Mm-hmm. How many Midwestern women were listening to this song? Let me set the mood. It's a cold winter's day. You live in Nebraska. You're envisioning the Marlboro Man riding his horse up to your front door. This song starts to play. You leave your husband. He's so lame. He works on tractors. You leave him. You walk out the door. You get on the back of the horse and go into the sunset. And this song comes on. Turn it up for this part. This is where it hits.
There he is.
Just staring out into the Montana sky.
Yeah.
That was,
this
yeah.
song is fantasy. This song is a fantasy.
I thought you were alluding to that this song is the equivalent to what Mariah Carey's fantasy is to R&B fans, to country fans. Like, this is the Mariah Carey fantasy of country.
Wow.
I was like, holy crap, this is that is some high praise.
I wish I could make a meta parallel like that, but that's just not happening. That is just
literally
not
bizarre.
Happening. I am limited. Not possible.
There's only one fantasy.
No. God.
If a cowboy showed up to your door and was like, "All right, it's time. We got to go be cowboys together. Like, we're gonna drive. We're gonna. I mean, maybe it's Brokeback Mountain style. I don't know. You take your pick. But you
it's
just are going,
baby.
Yeah, you're going out with this cowboy to live the cowboy lifestyle. Would you, if you were like guaranteed, you know, not to die and to be able to have success in that lifestyle? Is that something that you would do?
You mean, would I go to Westworld? Yes. Yes, I would go to Westworld.
I guess that's what I'm asking you. I'm asking if you would go to Westworld.
Yes. Endless robot sex and gunfighting? Yes, please. Take me to Westworld.
That is
that's
the best
all
part
that
of that
show.
Was.
That was actually the original title of this song was Cowboy Take Me Away to Westworld.
To Westworld, yeah. Dude, Westworld was creepy as hell. That's so gnarly.
It's so creepy. And what is really creepy is that it is true that, like you said, all that is happening in the show for most part is people fucking and killing robots. Mm-hmm. But you know that if that place existed for real, that is all that would happen.
Exactly.
In that world. It's like, you could do anything in here. What do you want to do? Go on an adventure? Maybe see how it is to go hunt down like an old prospector? Nope, let's go fuck some people and then kill them literally the second after I'm done.
It's like
that's
Grand
all that
Theft
show
Auto.
Is, dude. Yeah, it is like, oh my, you're right. They're not going to like, it's not the people that want to get immersed in the experience.
No.
No way.
Exactly.
You'd like have a couple, like some like really hardcore LARPers who like old West LARPers with their gear on, and they come out and they're like, "Well, I'm going down to the well to get some gold.
I brought my own hat from home."
I brought my own hat.
And that's how they talk when they're like, "All right, now I'm gonna go home and get out of Westworld. All right, now I'm gonna see, I guess I'll drive home. Gotta stop at the store, drop off this gold panning equipment at the rental place."
The show's demented.
But that's
what I think about when I think about this show. Or when I think about this song. I feel
you think
like
about Westworld?
I think about Westworld, just a robotic cowboy picking me up and taking me away.
It is a romantic thought.
Yeah,
it is.
It's beautiful.
Clarke, what is it about
his
country
wires
that hits
and spurs clinking against his boots?
Wait, what'd you say, Nucky?
What is it about country that is so connecting to you? Other, I mean, obviously being, you know, grown on country, you know, obviously there's such a connection to you on that level. Mm-hmm. But what is it with country, the genre? Because you do listen to a lot of stuff, which is why I love you. One of the reasons I love you so much. But what is it with country? Why do you keep going back
to it? Yeah. That's a good question. I live, you know, just growing up in Santa Margarita, having parents and family that were all in agriculture and really steeped in the culture of like living in the West. It's just like there's something about country that's kind of fun. It's like a identity. And that's why I like the earlier stuff, because now it's just kind of like really tied in with a part of America that I don't really associate with.
Mm-hmm.
But growing up, it's like this genre that is so much about like raw human emotion and like this caricature of Western life, the sensitive, rugged man, the complicated, hard, you know, the tough,
the tall, dark, and handsome.
Yeah.
Like,
it's all these people, these characters that are like really, you know, they're like all a John Wayne movie, when in reality, mm-hmm. like John Wayne was a racist piece of shit. But
right,
there's this narrative that we build in our head that's like really fun, right? That we get this image of this person. And so country music is like, and maybe that's putting too much into it, but it's just fun. You know, it's kind of like, it's so cheesy. Country music is so cheesy. And there's like a pleasure in that of just being able to like give in to how cheesy it is, how sappy the songs are. Mm-hmm. 'Cause the love songs are so sappy.
Yeah.
You know? You listen to like old George Jones, like the Grand Tour by George Jones is like so needlessly, torturously sad, but he's like, I'm going to make some hits with this one. Like he knew it was good, but it's so like his wife abandoned him with their baby. And you're like, damn, this is like really heavy, but it.
There's really a fine line between country music and folk music. A good country music. Because it does come from a place of just kind of like it is, I would say, one of the more solitary genres. I would say that like country and maybe like a rapper are the two that are, or in like a pop star, you know, when it's just one person who's kind of done the work, and maybe not the, you know, they still have a band behind him or whatever, but it's one person is telling their story and kind of creating with what they have. It usually comes out pretty relatable, and I feel like with the when you're a rural person and you have an acoustic guitar and you're like, you know, singing what you have experienced, you get that sound a lot, which is defined as folk sometimes and country sometimes, I think, depending on whether or not you have an accent.
Yeah. It's like, it's funny. I feel like it reaches out to the whole demographic that like Trump was trying to reach out into America, like the forgotten rural people, but then he just like got them hooked on conspiracy theories and overthrowing democracy. But like, you know what I mean? Like country people like all over the place are like, I'm sensitive, I love country music. And they got this part of them that's like, they all connect on it. And I don't know, it's cool. It's like kind of like the ballad of the working middle class that's pretty fun to be in tune with. At least it was. Now it's like,
right.
Like we've gone over it a million. It's literally, it's just so, it's pop music without the good beats or melody, right?
And like production. Like just trying to write,
Production. Yeah. Like the content's the same, right? Like I'm here to have a good time. I'm here to dance. I'm here to party, but without any of the good catchy lyrics, none of the good rapping, and just like too many broad rimmed hats.
Yeah.
Too many.
Yep.
And just this culture of like, I don't give a fuck about nothing. I'm just here to fucking party and not care.
Yeah, that's exactly, you know, it's like, I'll go to Daytona. Don't. You won't stop me. Yeah. It's like, yeah.
It's a very toxically masculine culture.
It just makes me feel like it's just been a cold day in July.
Here we go.
Not going to trump that segue. This doesn't sound like, this could be anybody, band.
Yeah.
This could be a you know, some song from the 90s, like Lifehouse, you know, or Nirvana. Or whatever.
Exactly.
Yeah. All night
long, I've pleaded, and it's just because she has the country style, which has a lot of the, I don't know, it almost sounds like they're yodeling sometimes.
Yeah, she definitely got that yodeling vibe on it. She just can belt it out. I know. I'm sure I would love to... I'm always so obsessed with Time Machine and going to concerts, music moments and stuff. Love to take a Time Machine and go see the Dixie Chicks in like a Nashville bar or like a bar in Texas, like right before they've signed the deal, but just like get that raw. Like this, like in a small little bar, you're just like, ooh. I can hear this back in the patio.
I think that's another draw of country music is a lot of it is, it does feel like you could be playing, it's romantic, you know, you could be playing this in a bar. Like when I hear this song, I am immediately transported to exactly like you said, a bar, you know, sitting at a table with a drink, just kind of like sitting over it and, you know, it's a cold day in July. And so you just get the emotion from it immediately.
Yeah, totally.
You know, Yeah, it's really good at putting the emotion across. That's for sure. I think that can be said of any good artist. You know, that's the yes. enduring musicians are able to communicate in more than just lyrically.
I think the Dixie Chicks kind of remind me in a way cross genre to like Sheryl Crow, like so popular when Sheryl Crow was like in her heyday. Mm-hmm. Like you could not be more popular than Sheryl Crow.
Yeah.
Right? Like you're the biggest thing in the world. Dixie Chicks, same thing. Mm-hmm. Then they get into a little bit of heat and all of a sudden everybody's like, it's not cool to like Sheryl Crow, like she's so cheesy. But now we've gotten past that and we're like, oh damn, like
it was our generation's fault.
It's so good. Yeah.
I'm sorry, Sheryl Crow. It was our fault that you went down for a while. Gen Z is saving you again.
Yeah. You know what the Dixie Chicks reminds me of is Heart. They're like country Heart.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point.
Oh God. What's that Heart song? Steamboat Annie. I love that song.
Yeah. A biopic is being made about them, and Carrie Brownstein is directing it.
Oh no way.
Yeah, it's gonna be dirty. I can't
wait.
That's
gonna be sick.
Yeah, that's gonna be amazing.
Shouldn't that word be pronounced biopic? Discuss. Speak on this.
Biopic?
Biopic.
No, I don't like the way. Biopic. Yeah, exactly. It's too robotic.
You know, because it's a biography.
Biography.
It's a picture of a biography.
It's a biographical picture.
I know it's biopic. I know it is.
It's Dreamboat Annie by Heart, not Steamboat Annie.
Yeah, I was saying that was a Mickey Mouse cartoon.
Yeah, that's the famous. No, that's Steamboat Willie. Yes, it's a Steamboat.
Yeah.
It was Steamboat
no,
Annie Hall.
Kuda.
Yeah, yeah, Steamboat Annie Hall. It was a Woody Allen cartoon.
Yeah, not fun anymore. I forgot we're not allowed to like him. You know what? Fuck it. I'm gonna say it. I still enjoy him. I mean, not I'm gonna support it, but I still watch the movies.
Hey,
I'm sorry.
Oh, you're talking because he married his adopted daughter.
Well, the possibility of sexual misconduct with another daughter. Underage daughter.
Oh God, I had no idea.
It's just too.
I was never a fan, but now I know to stay away.
Stay away.
All right.
Stay away.
Stay.
If I ran into Woody Allen, I would just hold up my hand and be like, "Goodbye, Earl."
This also, "Goodbye, Earl" is I feel like it's like the country equivalent of like Becky with the good hair or like "Bye, Felicia."
Oh no, it is, dude. You need to listen to the content in the song. It tackles some heavy topics.
Goodbye, Earl sounds like a used car salesman. Hey, I'm Goodbye, Earl. You know, when you come to Earl's, you're going to get a goodbye.
Every time you step on the lot, you're going to be in a car saying goodbye, Earl.
You want a Pontiac? Show up to Earl's used cars. You want a Plymouth? Show up to Earl's used cars. Say goodbye to Earl when you leave the parking lot.
And tell Earl you got a goodbye.
You got a good. Oh wow.
Yeah, that's the joke I was making from the very beginning.
Oh. Damn, it's hard to keep up with comedians.
No, just Rick. Me.
I just had to put enough of a gap in there.
This is just this is just like Rick's stand up, like when he tells his jokes on stage, he's like, you know, like that.
Women be shotgun shooting men with a shotgun.
That's what they covered in the song, right?
Yeah,
it's heavy. You thought it was fun. You thought it was a fun romp in the hay with your friends out in Tallahassee.
Nope.
And it's not.
Nope.
It is about domestic violence and getting retribution and revenge on a domestic abuser and killing them. It's about murder, cover-up, intrigue. It's essentially a House of Cards episode.
It's a murder mystery wrapped up in a song.
In a fun beat.
It's heavy.
Yeah. And this goes back to one of my favorite things that some songs do, which is fun melodies and music and like you're like dancing around, but like when you listen to the lyrics is very sad, dark, murderous. Like I just that is just one of my favorite things that musicians do and we'll never get tired of it.
It's great. And you know,
yeah, like Semi-Charmed Life, the song Semi-Charmed Life is about doing meth.
Ah,
like it sounds like such a happy song, do 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 do. But if you read the lyrics, it's like about somebody totally losing themselves to drugs, and it's crazy.
Oh my god!
Super hard sidebar. Let's see, there we go. Super hard sidebar. I've been meaning to a theme going in the podcast, and I keep forgetting to ask people this, but I'm going to continue it right now. Clarke, did you know that the band name Pearl Jam is actually a reference to semen?
No.
Are you serious?
Okay.
Okay.
Rick has blown my mind.
I told Nick this 70 fucking episodes ago. I don't know how many episodes ago. At the beginning of this podcast, I told Nick that. And I was like, oh, you know, everybody knows, you know, Pearl Jam means come. And he was just like, what? Really? And I was like, you don't know? And then literally every person we've brought it up to has been like, oh, really? And I'm like, I thought that was such a, like, common knowledge thing.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, Pearl Jam.
Just like re-questioning all the ticket stubs that he has in his book.
They say they make up a story that it's a reference to his grandma or his aunt or something, Pearl, who made really good jam. Bullshit.
Okay.
Bullshit, Eddie Vedder. You made your band about cum. Don't fucking lie.
Don't blame it on your grandma.
I'm on a blog called Rule42.com by Gavin Edwards, and he said, where did Pearl Jam get their name? And he said it had something to do with... I don't want to read this. I don't care about this. What am I doing?
What is happening?
I don't care.
You're reading Eddie Vedder fan fiction.
Yeah. I lost myself.
And then Eddie walked into my room and he strummed a chord and he said, Jeremy spoke in class today and he told me how sexy you were.
Okay, cool. So anyway,
I'm glad that sidebar is over.
All right, sidebar is closed. Last call.
I didn't know. I thought that was common knowledge. All right.
I mean, the more we ask people that, the more I want to just. I think Rick feels like he should just say hello to Mr. Heartache.
Hello, Mr. Ba-doom-doom. Heartache. I've been expecting you.
Ooh.
All right, this is the most country-sounding song so far.
Yeah. It's got that morning for it. We found the country.
You're listening to some...
Yeah.
Yeah. Texas Swing, so they are Texas girls born and raised. They'll be playing
Clarke,
Texas-style country music, and this is definitely in that realm.
Yes. Being a country fan, I have a question for you, sir, Mr. Andros.
What's up?
Right here. Misa, please.
Yes, sir.
God, I lost it. Oh, being a country fan as you are, have you ever had any country swing nights at the Grad here in San Luis Obispo?
Okay, never been to country night at the Grad ever. Never, ever in my whole life. Scared. So scared of what could it be going on there.
Are you a country dancer?
No, I've only done it once. I was on tour and we stopped in Austin and this band I knew was playing a show at a country swing bar. And so I went and we went with some Texas people and they showed me how to do the
line
dancing. The basic step. Yeah, like the basic line step. And I was just so bad at it. That's why I'm telling stories about when I did play shows because I have no rhythm. I am a retired musician. Yeah. I realized pretty quickly I can't dance, can't keep a rhythm, can't remember the lyrics to my own songs, and so that's why I used to be a country folk singer, and now I'm a teacher. So
well,
you know.
They say if you can't do, teach. Let's move. Yeah.
Story of my life.
On that note, let's take the final break of the show, and then we come back, we will have the last 7 songs of the album, and we'll wrap this thing up when we return on Spin Doctors. All right, and we are back, of course, with the Dixie Chicks. The Chicks. Is it rude to call them the Dixie Chicks now? Is that like dead naming them?
We should make sure that we say the Chicks.
They're the Chicks.
They're
the Chicks.
It's the Chicks. Yes. Woke.
Yeah.
Woke.
This is the Chicks Fly. This album, which generally is, I am digging. I didn't think that I was going to be liking this album as much as I am, and I thought that I was going to have to be pretending to like this, and there was that one country, more country sounding song, but even while it was playing, her voice is so good, and she doesn't sound... I think I just hate male country artists. I think that's what I'm finding out. I think I hate that sound of the, you got a fucking dear bear girl.
No, there's a reason you don't like them.
Yeah.
What's next? Don't waste your heart?
And it's fine. It's fine. Hang on. I got to segue for this one.
Okay.
okay. Hang on. Let's give it a try. Let me stretch. Let me stretch. I gotta travel a long way for this one. All right. And it's fine if I don't like those kinds of country music, because I can like other kinds of country music, and that way I don't have to I can tell myself, don't waste your heart on those other
I'm so glad we halted.
Don't waste your heart.
You pulled a hammy on that one.
Yeah, you know, I ran out of steam.
Yeah, you really stretched some
can I get
of the time
a point for trying
one. No, that was the 10% that I was told you about.
Ah, goddammit. Can't you see
Now, Clarke, you're a man of love.
Yeah.
You're a man of the cloth.
You're a man of the cloth.
I am in love.
Jesus.
Yeah.
You have been, you are, you will be.
Yep.
Forevermore. Was there any country music at your wedding?
You know, we danced to Wild Horses by the Rolling Stones, and that's a country song. I think the Rolling Stones always had a little bit of country in them.
Oh, absolutely. Mm. That's why I think, not to just like jump into your story, but when they say that like you're either a Beatles person or a Rolling Stones person generally, I think that that's very true. And I think that I found the Beatles, and so that's why I don't have any connection to country music. Some people find the Rolling Stones and they get that southern country influence.
That's a nice little point there, Richard. I like it.
It's my theory.
There is,
that's nice.
It is nice. This is like a classic sad country song. This is something you could cry into your Budweiser into, or cry into your Budweiser with.
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely. That's it's. I assume that it's about wasting your love on somebody who didn't deserve
classic.
It. Yep.
The next, honestly, the next song I want you to listen to, because this, I think, Sin Wagon is what you would consider a barn burner in the industry.
Ooh, is that a country banger?
Is that synonymous with like a bop?
It's like it goes hard. Like it burns down. You're playing so fast and you're playing so good that you burn down the barn. A barn burner.
Oh, all right. Well, it's got a perfect name for it. It sounds like a death metal country band.
Sin Wagon.
This is Sin Wagon.
Oh, okay. Okay, chicks. Oh, okay. Yep, this is.
Okay, yeah. See, I can get down to this.
Elbow movement.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
It's all dancing, like, you know, just moving the shoulders and then the legs.
I like thinking that, like, when they played this in concert, like, that opening there, like, let that ring out, like, a lot longer and just, like, fucking jump into this and, like, it is going down. This is the closest.
And as soon as, like, it goes, and then all the audience is like,
and then just, like, gets into it. Also, this is probably the closest, like, to a mosh pit a country concert gets to. Just, like, this is mosh worthy. Just up and down, getting into each other, getting it all, the big pit in the circle, just,
I was at a Hank Williams III concert that there were mosh pits at.
That guy's wild.
That was an amazing concert.
He's wild.
I thought you were making a bad joke again, but that is real.
No.
Wow.
Yeah. Have you ever listened to Hank Williams III?
I didn't know.
We call him Hank III.
He's like a cowpunk guy. Third.
Yeah.
Cowpunk, dude.
Yeah,
it's a whole genre.
Of the three, I like one and three.
Yeah.
Because two is that like more kind of like, you know.
Yeah,
country
that we've been
think of when I think
enjoying.
Of country music.
Yeah.
He's great. Well, I mean, I love Hank too. Bo Cephas.
He's very, very popular and very, very loved. You know.
Yeah, Bo Cephas. Well, that's a crazy nickname, though. I mean,
yeah.
It's honestly, it's. Too
I think
much.
That was Alexander the Great's horse. His name.
Bo
Eucephalus.
Eucephalus.
So close.
So close
to Bocephus.
Bocephus?
I wonder if that's where he got it. I don't know. And I don't know why I know that.
That was, wow.
That's some history.
I'm not even mad. I'm impressed.
I know two things in this world. Pearl Jam means come, and that man's horse was named Beautiful Head.
I can't wait till you have your, like, Slumdog Millionaire moment where you get on a game show, and those are the two questions you get asked, and the whole nation is just on the edge of their seat. Just like, I don't know what Pearl Jam really means, and who the hell was Alexander the Great? He had a horse? And then you're just going to be the small-town hero that wins the whole game, having flashbacks to when you learned it.
$1 million. I'm going to be like that guy who called his dad just to tell him that he won.
Yep.
There's a video of a guy who won on
the first millionaire. The most, like, G thing on, like, a game show ever.
Wait, he called on his lifeline to tell his dad.
Yeah, he used his lifeline on the final question, the million-dollar question, and called his dad. And Regis reads the question to him, and he's like, all right, you're 30 seconds. Or no, he's like, oh, hey, dad, your son wants to talk to you. You know, he's got a question for you for the $1 million or whatever. And your 30 seconds starts now. And he turns it over to the guy and he goes, hey, dad, how are you doing? Dad's like, oh, I'm good, son. How are you? He's all pretty good. Just wanted to tell you I'm about to win the $1 million. And then he just answers it on the phone, there. And he's just like, are you sure? And he hangs up and he's right. And he's just like, boom. And it was the coolest video. I love that video.
Okay.
That's a great poll.
I need to watch that. I used to love that show.
It's a fantastic video.
I loved that show. Kind of same era as I was listening to Dixie Chicks at first, you know?
I'll just pull it up. Let's watch that video.
Yeah. R.I.P. Regis. And I guess that guy that won Millionaire should say, I would have won Millionaire without you, Richard Nixon.
Oh, Regis, where would we be without you?
Just the no. I don't like this. No. Oh, how about no?
Good God, that was one of the best videos I've seen in a long time.
It's fantastic.
That was a great poll, Rick.
That was the biggest flex.
Thank you.
That is big dick energy before we knew it.
This is very pretty.
The level of that video and then now to this song is just kind of
the
like,
contrast.
It's like the Molly has already taken effect and now it's the come down.
Exactly. We're like, okay, now I can't really even enjoy this.
Clark, have we already gone past your favorite song? I know you already noted that there was one of your favorite songs, but is there like a favorite song on here?
Cowboy Take Me Away is hands down my favorite song on the album. Hands down.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. That makes sense.
Not even close.
It's not even close.
It's not even a fucking... Don't even ask me that question. That's insulting that you would ask me that.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I would have thought you guys did your research.
Sometimes
I walk straight into bullshit. No, hang on. Nope. Sometimes I walk straight into putting my foot in my mouth, and some days you gotta dance.
Okay.
No. Okay, here it is. Here's the pick me up. On the double vinyl, this is the B-side.
This is Jimmy's Watering Hole, Mid-State Fair, 1999. Ooh. You know, everybody's just ripped off their ass on Budweiser's and margaritas. It's a hot August night in Paso Robles. The dust's in the air. You can hear the animals mooing, cawing, whatever they do. And you're here. You spot that.
Oinking.
You're oinking. You spot that blonde girl across the bar too, with the low-rise cowgirl cut jeans. And you're just ripping up on the dance floor. Yeah.
You're all oinking. Everybody's oinking.
That's the thing of the trend. Just think, have you guys been to the Mid-State Fair? Have you guys been to that?
Okay.
That's a great segue.
Have you been, Rick? I can't tell if that was sarcastic or not.
Oh, no, I've been. I used to go every single year. Okay. And then I stopped going a few years ago.
Okay.
It is literally the crossroads of human culture.
Yes.
The people that show up for that fair.
For Paso Robles.
It's
Ranchella.
It's Coachella for the methadone crowd. That's what it is.
Yeah, it is.
It is like
there's like it's a mix of there's children there to ride rides, there's alcoholics there to drink a lot of beer,
and then there's children on those rides.
Yeah, and then there's teenagers there to fuck each other, and then there's a bunch of twacked out people.
Yeah,
and that's the demographics that arrive there at the Mid-State Fair.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, God. Yeah, that's where they would, like, show the promotional material for Music to Love Your Cousin By, that CD. It'd be, like, them interviewing people on the street, like, what do you think about this song? And they'd be at the Mid-State Fair. I've seen the craziest stuff there, just, like, drunk people, lots of animals getting out.
What's one that always pops to mind when you think of Mid-State Fair craziness?
Well, I just remember... going with my brother, because we used to have to camp there for 2 weeks out in the hot sun, and we would show livestock. We would I was in it, dude. I would show animals at the fair, and I remember following my brother and all of his friends out. He was, like, quite a bit older, and they would do this thing where they would take cow shit from the barn, and they would bring it with them, and they would rub $1 bills in it and stick it out on the main thoroughfare. And so, like, drunk dudes would come up and grab the dollar bill and get poop all over their hands and then freak out, just belligerent, just screaming. Oh. And just remembering as a kid, like, oh, the power that you have over people. That's beautiful.
That's such a fun, like, kid thing to do.
That's because,
like,
on the one hand, no one can get hurt from that.
Yeah, exactly.
On the one hand, you have shit.
On one of your hands is shit, but on the other hand, there's a dollar that you got.
Yeah.
And you probably also got a little shit on that hand, too. But the kids get to have a laugh. You get upset, but it's only cow shit. It's not like it's human shit.
It's not like it's the first pile you stepped in at the Mid-State Fair.
Exactly. Yeah. You're at the Mid-State Fair. You've touched cow shit before.
Yeah. Don't act like you're surprised. You know where you are.
You got cow shit in your hands, and you got a hole in my head.
Oh, this is a good one.
Ooh.
Oh, this is cool. Just that cool bass line.
What's happening? Yeah. Ooh.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to give it whistle the for
this
whistle.
This seems like a Monday Night Football theme.
Yeah, like some robot would be out with a football and, like, spike it through the Earth's crust.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's just like... spike! And he catches a pass from God. Catches a pass from God. Jesus tackles him.
God is wearing a Russell Wilson jersey because Russell Wilson is God. There you go, Rick.
I can get on board with that.
I only did that for you because I do love Russell Wilson, and we both know that God is not a Kirk Cousins fan, but Kirk Cousins is a big God fan.
I was gonna say that.
Also,
speaking of fans of God, Philip Rivers retired.
Well, I'm stuck on the idea of Russell Wilson, because isn't he married to Ciara?
Yeah.
Yes, he is.
Of course God would be married to Ciara. That's a no-brainer.
Yeah, exactly.
If God was going to pick any woman on earth to pick as his wife, it's Ciara.
That's true.
Yeah.
That is
true. I just saw her on a Weight Watchers commercial, and she was radiant.
Of course she is, because she's Ciara.
She was glowing.
Her goodies were glowing. Yeah.
Yeah.
She one two step right into the salad aisle. Also, why is she on the diet thing? She is fine. That's weird.
Well, she's probably maintaining her figure by being on the diet.
Yeah, that's
and here we go.
True.
Just what Ciara needed: three white dudes talking about her figure on a podcast somewhere.
Talking about her figure too.
Yeah. God, we just fell right in. We are literally the scourge.
We are everything that's wrong with the world.
I'm so sorry.
And this is why white people, white men especially, are so, like, subtly terrible. Because we don't even know, like, we're just talking. We're just talking randomly.
Just
and then we're still, like...
It naturally happened.
It just happens.
We allowed a conversation we were having to naturally progress towards a point where we talked about... we pulled into question Ciara starring in a Weight Watchers commercial because we thought, in what world is Ciara's figure out of shape?
Exactly.
The fact that we even had opinions on that is something
we're vocalizing.
I'll tell you right now, that's 100 years in purgatory. Easy.
Oh, shit.
I don't know what the conversion is.
The answer to our question.
That's straight up commenting on
Ciara.
Okay, but
what do I have to do in purgatory? Do I just have to chill and wait there? Or do I have to, like, do dishes? Or am I taking lashes? Like, what's the degree?
No, you have to watch the Ciara Weight Watchers commercial for 100 years straight.
Dude, I'm okay with that.
I was confused why she was in the commercial, but it's still a terrible commercial. It's horrible. Love her, but...
You know why she's in the commercial? She's in the commercial so that that commercial can be used in purgatory later to torture people with.
Boom. Yeah,
and that makes sense.
Who have judged her. Boom. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. And it will take you straight to Heartbreak Town.
That's the smoothest one, yeah.
That's good. We're usually really good on this, Clark. This has been a bumpy road.
Sure. Release the tapes and I'll believe it.
Release the Kraken.
I think Tom Arnold has the tapes.
1200 miles and you never asked why.
This isn't too ballady either. There's been I'm pretty hit and miss on ballads. To be honest, I have to be in the right kind of like space to really enjoy it and stuff. And if I'm in
ballads
a happy
like
place,
of any kind, of any genre,
yeah, you know, it just got to be the right mood. If I'm really happy, gotta stay away from them. I can't. My emotions are like too sensitive, and I'm like my happy days are way too rare, so I can't mess up my vibe. Having said that,
okay,
preach, brother, preach.
Jonathan Van Ness taught me just like love myself and like you know accept myself. For
did
who
you
I
read
am,
his
honey.
Book?
No, I didn't realize he had a book.
Oh, he's
I have
got a
Anthony's
fantastic.
Cookbook,
it's called Over
though.
The Top. You have what?
I have Anthony's Cookbook.
Oh, that's dope.
Yeah.
Oh, is it just
I love Queer Eye. I love those guys so fucking much.
Me too.
That cookbook is all like, this is one way you can slice an avocado. This is another way you can slice an avocado. And sometimes I like to crack a little salt on my avocado. And I'm just going to put a little oil on it. And that's a meal for your whole family of five. You're welcome. Yeah. And then that one guy, Bobby... Bobby's back is thrown out because he just replaced drywall over a two-story house in Minneapolis.
He fixed that bathroom you left in disrepair.
Yeah, that you left in disrepair. And meanwhile, Anthony and Tan have taught some middle-aged cop how to French tuck and how to make a salad out of an avocado and a tomato. And poor Bobby is just like working it.
And they show him the least, too.
The least. Oh, yeah. Oh my God, the least. And he's like... with a nail gun on the floor, like, putting hardwood in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, it's the 1800s.
In the third season or something, they started, like, having him go out on more of the like, things. Like, all of a sudden, like, Bobby's, like,
oh, yeah, to
going
go
to
buy
the gym
stuff.
With them. Or, like, oh, he's going to go help, like, pick out the couches and everything. It's, like, watching the first two seasons, the showrunners and probably the guys themselves were like, yeah, Bobby isn't in this because he's doing the work.
I wonder how that went down, like, the first time that, like, Bobby goes out on an outing with Karamo, and he's like, oh, I'm really excited to see what Karamo does the whole episode. And then Karamo's just like, oh, man, you have problems with your dad? Like, you should probably think about that. And Bobby's like, are you fucking
kidding me, dude? We went out and got soup and talked for 15 minutes. It was a pretty tough day.
I rebuilt an entire 3-bedroom home in a week, and Karamo gives the guy 2 sentences over some sparkling water. That's what I'm up against. You know he was going into contract negotiations immediately after he figured that out.
He's bitch, pay me.
Yeah.
Oh, this is changing that dude, right
I do
now.
Everything.
Yeah, you know. That dude works
so
hard.
Oh,
that
is hilarious. Oh, I've been up since 4 in the morning. Karamo got up at 10. It was a half an hour late to the meeting.
I swear to God, if you don't pay me more, I'm going to let him fly. This is the last track on the album, boys. We've made it all the way through the album.
And it's been a beautiful journey.
It has been an absolutely beautiful journey. Like, this was... When you started talking about country music, my heart dropped. I was like, fuck.
This is gonna be a long couple hours.
I have to sit through... Yeah, exactly. But... Yeah. Literally with the first song, it immediately changed my mood, and progressively as we've gone through, I've just been like, oh, this is actually really good.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actually gonna add Sin Wagon here to my playlist.
Hell yeah.
Ooh, that's a stamp of honor.
A stamp of honor or a badge of honor.
Jesus. Yes.
Well, you can stamp a badge, and you can turn a badge into a stamp.
Okay, okay.
Natalie Maines on vocals. So good. Emily Robinson, acoustic guitar, banjo, and dobro. And she's credited as hand clapping. So that gets you credit on the Wikipedia page.
That's a new bucket list thing I want. I want to be credited as the hand clapper on an album. I want that liner notes accreditation.
Okay. We should get our bands back together, and we'll have Nick clap for us.
That's perfect.
Well, we did it. 13 tracks.
That's a
Dixie
long
Chicks
album.
Fly. That
back
was...
When an, yeah, back when an album was an album.
Exactly.
Yeah, right?
That was so good.
Seriously.
I did not hate that. I did not hate 1 second of that.
No.
I'm glad. That makes me really happy.
Like, honestly, I cannot tell you. Like I just said, you know, my heart dropped at the beginning, and here we are now. I've added one of the songs to my playlist, and I'm like, damn, this is fantastic. Thank you for sharing this with us.
I'm glad, dude. The chicks are the best.
Hell yeah, dude. I'm going to get me a Dixie Chicks t-shirt.
Hell yeah, brother.
Nick, what do you think? What do you think of all this?
Oh, me? This was great. I had high hopes because even though I don't listen to the chicks, I respect them a lot. I know they're very important. And like I was mentioning earlier, my uncle, huge country fan, but I know he loves the chicks too. So I was like, okay, definitely had a soft spot from the get-go. And they're just great. This is awesome music. Good, solid country. Solid 90s country.
I couldn't have said it better myself. So good, so much fun. Do you want to plug anything, Clark? What do you got going on? What do you want to tell the people about?
So plugs. One is, if you're interested, there's a project going on led by a gal named Zoe Zappas in Atascadero, California. It's called the Equality Mural Project. I'm one of the featured artists for their new project, where they've taken community funding, community businesses that they partner with, to create art for the public space that embraces equality. Atascadero is a historically uninclusive town, having been built on the premise of white supremacy, and the town and the people in it are trying to redefine that town's ethos, change it around, flip it on its head, put art in the public square that embraces equality, people from different backgrounds. And so Zoe's got an art exhibit up right now. They just got written up in New Times. And there's an article on it in Atascadero News. My mural looks like right now is actually going to be painted inside the tunnel that goes underneath the 101 freeway from the junior high to the high school.
Oh, awesome.
It's kind of fun.
Nice.
And so, I used to
walk through that tunnel every day. Every day from high school, I walked through.
I know exactly
that
tunnel you're talking about. Yeah, by the high school.
Yeah. Yep. So, I'm going to be painting that in there, which is fun. You know, I teach right up the hill at Atascadero High School. I'm going to have some students help me out. It's a haiku that I wrote. It's like a repeating art piece. So that's my one big plug. That'll be fun. Hopefully that'll go up within the next couple months. And then the other one would probably be, most definitely be my partner. Nick mentioned her earlier. She's just the queen of the side hustle. If you want a beanie, a sweater, anything, McKenna, your GF on Instagram. She makes the best stuff. And I'm going to plug her because I think it's awesome. She designs really cool clothing. Mm-hmm. We do a lot of stuff together. She's always been helped me with all of my art. And I'm going to do what little I can for her art because I can't crochet for shit. And I've got big stubby fingers. But she makes some great stuff. And it's super fun. She's doing like super creative things. And awesome. 10% of the proceeds, it might be more, 10% of the proceeds go towards aid programs for LGBTQ community and COVID relief and stuff like that. So, people of color, BIPOC
That's
community,
awesome.
And LGBT aid funds that are in the county or anywhere else. That's what's going on.
Some very selfless plugs.
Super cool.
Well, I love it.
I would love it if the mural helped skyrocket my literary career. So it's a roundabout plug for what I hope to happen.
Exactly.
So,
yeah.
I'll take what I can get.
Take the fucking compliment, Clark. Jesus Christ.
but Thanks for having me on. This has been awesome.
Thanks
I
for
love
being here. This
music.
Was a lot
yeah.
of fun.
Yes.
Yeah.
And thank you for being here, Clarke.
Yeah,
and,
no problem, guys.
Of course, thank you to Pale Blue Dot for our theme for you off the album Kingdom, Phylum, Class, Order, Family, Genus, Species. It's a great album. Get it wherever albums are sold or streamed. You can find us at Twitter or Instagram at SpinDocPod, and you can email us if you want to talk to us, have any questions, have anything you want to say, any comments about stuff, suggestions, anything, at SpinDoctorsPod@gmail.com. This has been a lot of fun. Thank you, Nick, for being here. Thank you, Clarke, for being here. And as always, I've been Rick.
I've been Nick.
And we hope you enjoyed your medicine!
Bye!